Thanks for tuning into the Public Domain Plays podcast.
When choosing this month's play, we polled our very impressive social media following to see what you wanted to hear.
And you said you wanted to hear something you'd never heard before.
After many hours of research, I found this gem for you, Cheating Cheaters by Max Marcin. In this case, gem is also a pun because this play is about a jewelry heist.
Time to meet our marvelous actors.
Hi, I'm Laura Barnes. My pronouns are she, her, and I'll be playing Steve Wilson and Mrs. Palmer.
Hi, I am River. I use they, them, or she, her pronouns, and I'm going to be playing Antonio Verdi, also known as Tony the Wop, and Edward Palmer.
Hi, my name is Drew Vollmer. My pronouns are he, him, and I will be playing George Brockton and Mr. Hanley.
My name is Haz Katie. My pronouns are he, him, and she, her, and I will be playing Mrs. Brockton.
Hi, my name is Aileen. My pronouns are she, her, and I will be playing Nan Carey.
Hello, everyone. My name is Shakira Searle. My pronouns are they, them, and I will be playing Ira Lazar and Grace Palmer.
Hi, my name is JJ Tyson. I go by he, him pronouns, and I'm going to be playing Tom Palmer.
Hi, my name is Alex Kingsley. I use they, them pronouns. I'm going to be playing Phil and Holmes.
That's everybody tonight, or we're actually recording during the day, so that's everybody today. Public Domain Plays presents Cheating Cheaters by Max Marcin.
Tony, is it Nan back yet?
No, not yet.
Hold on there, Steve. Why don't you throw open the window and poke your head out? Somebody will be sure to see you then.
No bull would expect to find me in a swell joint like this.
Obviously not, but the unexpected is the chief danger of our work.
Yes, one mistake, one little slip-up, and we're lost.
Well, I'm sick of being cooped up here.
$500,000 worth of jewels is a prize worth waiting for.
That's all right, but when I go after a guy's rocks, I take a jimmy and a gun. I don't rent no swell house in the country and give a tea party for his family. Those ain't my methods.
Let me tell you something. You keep on with those methods, and it won't be long before you're caught.
Me get caught? Not a chance. They'll have a lively time getting me.
Stop that.
Hey, hey! Stop that. You're absolutely crazy with recklessness.
If you're so fond of showing that gun, why don't you hang it around your neck?
And go out in the street shouting what a desperate character you are.
Say, has he got a cannon out again?
Yes, and when this dog barks, he not only shows his teeth, but he bites.
Where's Nan? Ain't she come home yet?
No, and I ain't stuck on these long walks she's taking alone every day either.
Well, if I'd never been mugged for the gallery and wasn't in danger of being picked up every time I set foot outdoors, I'd be getting a little exercise myself.
Listen, before Nan gets back, there's something I want to get off my chest.
Well, get it off!
If the Palmers are coming here to tea this afternoon, now's the time to speak up. I don't believe Nan is going through for us.
What?
Nan throw us down? Oh, nonsense.
Maybe not, but I've got a hunch she's stalling us.
Stalling us?
Yes. Her fingers may be itching for those Palmer stones, but her heart ain't in the job.
What's her heart got to do with it?
The dame don't live that won't fall for the right guy, and the right man has come along for Nan.
You mean Tom Palmer?
That's who I mean. Tom Palmer. Now we've staked everything on this job. We're in hock to Lazar for the coin to plant ourselves in this house, and it cost a couple of thousand more to send Nan and George to Europe.
Say, are you still under the delusion that it was a pleasure jaunt? Ha! Less than a fortnight on the other side and the war breaks out. And after we manage to squeeze on board a ship for home, the confounded ship strikes a mine. Oh, it was a lovely excursion.
That's the point I'm leading up to. When that ocean buggy hit that mine and she saw the man she started out to trim standing on that sinking ship, lifting the women and children into the lifeboats, well, she stopped looking on him as a fall guy. He became her hero.
Oh, pshaw.
If you think I'm wrong, why has she been playing around with him all this time? Why?
She's leading him on.
Leading him on?
Yes, leading him on. Can't you get that through that mush head of yours?
It looks to me like she was hanging on. And when a girl is in love with a guy and wants to hang on to him, she puts her hand on his shoulder, not in his pocket.
Pshaw! Many a dame has put one hand on a man's shoulder while lifting his watch with the other.
Let me put you wise to something. When Lazar sent for me 5 months ago, he says, Steve, there's a high-class mob planted on a job in the suburbs, and they want an expert safe man. They're framing it to get on the inside, and they want you to blow the safe. I told him I never worked with no high-class mob before, but half a million's worth of sparklers listened good to me, so I traveled along. But I want to declare myself right now. I hope I'm wrong about Nan.
You bet you are.
But either way, I'm going through with this job, and I'm going to make sure that all of you go through with me, including Nan.
What do you mean?
This job is going to be pulled off, whether Nan wants it or not, and if she makes one false move before them Palmers...
Here's Nan now.
Shh, here she is.
Yes.
Not a word to her. Let's see what happens this afternoon.
Hello, everybody.
Hello, Nan. What are you made up for?
For your 19-year-old daughter, of course.
You can't pull that on us, Nan.
And for pity's sake, don't call me Nan. From now on, I'm Ruth. Ruth Brockton, George's daughter. The same as on the boat. Wouldn't it be lovely if the Palmers on their first visit heard one of you call me Nan? And from now on, you're supposed to be my mother. Now, don't forget that, Nellie.
Yes, Ruth.
And now, help me get this room into shape.
It certainly needs it.
George, pick up those papers. Steve, put those flowers in that vase. Now, George, for heaven's sake, put away that pipe.
All right, Nan.
There you go. Nan again. And there's no excuse for you, George, after having been my father all the way to Europe and back.
I'll remember. Ruth.
There. That's better. Now, boys, come here. Now, don't forget this. Whether we get those Palmer jewels or not depends on our cleverness this afternoon. All I want is one night in the Palmer home, and the way we have it framed, I ought to get the invitation before they leave. Do you all know what to do when they get there? Don't you think we had better go over it again?
You needn't go through it again for my sake.
Nor for mine.
I always was a lady before company. What's the matter with you?
Imagine Nell serving tea to the Palmers.
Ha! Ha! Are you afraid I'm to make a break? I'll have you know I've been hostess to many a tea party.
Yes, but there's always been plenty of bartenders to do the serving.
Now, boys, don't forget your part for this afternoon's party. George, you're my father. Nellie, you're my mother. Tony, you're supposed to be my music teacher. And Steve, you're our new butler. And when, for heaven's sake, you announce the Palmers, don't bawl the name out as though you felt your lungs needed exercise.
Gee, that's a swell job. Head usher for a gang of crooks. I ought to write home and tell the folks how well I'm doing.
Oh, well, let's see how well you are doing. Now, imagine you are showing in the visitors. Let's hear you announce them.
Yes. Go ahead, Steve. Something tells me you need more practice. Now imagine I'm playing the piano.
Get out of the way.
Ah, what's the matter with you?
Mrs. Palmer!
Where do you think you are?
That voice never belonged to any butler.
You're not announcing a prize fight.
Try it again.
Mrs. Palmer.
That is better.
Very much better indeed.
Now, Steve, here's the telegram I've prepared. You know when to spring it, don't you?
After tea has been served.
That's right. George, you're to read the telegram, and don't pass it around to be examined. If they even suspect it's phony, well, we might as well pack up and get out.
Oh, Ruth, here are the skeleton keys. You may need them when you get over to the house.
We're a hell of a gang to give a tea party.
Why the profanity?
Remember that even a burglar may be a gentleman.
Good manners don't crack no cribs.
Yes. Unfortunately, even good manners have their limitations.
That's Lazar's ring. Let him in.
Lazar? What the devil did he come up here for?
I sent him word that we had to have more money.
If anyone has trailed him up here, we're done for.
Thank heaven there's no one in sight.
I asked him to send the money, not to bring it.
That's the worst of having a backer. He's always scared somebody is holding out on him.
Nellie, you had better get into your clothes.
Yes, Mother, go upstairs and improve your figure.
This figure don't need improving. It needs remodeling. I'll be decked out like a circus horse in no time.
Good afternoon, Miss Brockton. Ah, George, you're looking well. My, my, plenty of books, eh, George? You must have been visiting the public library again. The first time I defended George, it was for furnishing his shelves from the public library. You see, George, I have a good memory.
Ira, if your legal knowledge was as good as your memory, you'd be a regular lawyer.
I received your letter, Miss Brockton.
Sit down, please. Have you brought the money?
I'm afraid I have some bad news. Very bad news, Miss Carey.
Bad news?
Spider Webb was convicted yesterday. And I had such a beautiful alibi for him.
Well, wasn't you his lawyer?
Yes, but even I couldn't save him. Had he been a $10,000 client, I couldn't have been more eloquent or wept more tears before that jury. Now he's in for 4 years, and all my witnesses are under arrest for perjury. My, my, times are awfully bad.
Is that to let us know we can't have the money?
$3,000 is a lot of money to advance just now.
But think of the profits.
I know, but you have already had $4,000.
If you want an accounting, I'll give you one. There's the renting of this house, the hiring of the furniture, the trip to Europe for George and me.
You know, Miss Carey, I never pry into what my clients do with their money.
Yes. The less you know, the safer it is for you. And you always play safe, don't you?
I'm afraid the game is no longer safe for any of us.
Not even for you, eh?
Look what happened to poor Spider. The police would have sprung him for me in a minute, but even their hands were tied. That detective, Ferris.
Ferris?
Ferris?
Yes, damn him. Ferris worked up the case against him, and what do you think one of their operatives had the nerve to say to me?
I don't know. What?
I was cross-examining him when he answered back that I was worse than a crook. That I was a backer and maker of crooks.
A vile slander, wasn't it?
And look at this.
A dick?
Yes, a dictograph.
Where did you find it?
Planted in my office by one of Ferris's men. Fortunately, I discovered it before any harm was done. But you see how insecure everything is.
All right. If you want security...
Sure, a bunch of it.
Would these satisfy you? The Stuyvesant jewels?
The Stuyvesant jewels?
Yes, and they're all there, except what Nell is wearing. Do you want to hold them as collateral until it is safe to market them?
Will it ever be safe to market them?
Sure, the bulls ain't going to devote all their lives to this one job.
Oh no, you are very clever, Miss Carey. Now, were I to take them, it would leave you clean and me with the goods. And now that Ferris handles the business for all the burglary insurance companies, he will never give up the search for them.
Let me understand you. You mean you're not going to advance us the $3,000?
Why do you need so much?
You know that we don't dare market any of these stones in this country, and the war kills any chance of disposing them in Europe, and now we will be in the same fix with the Palmer jewels. Now, we've got to have getaway money, and we're not going to wait for it until after the job. Either we get that money now, or I quit.
Now, Miss Carey, remember you have already had $4,000. I only mean to suggest that this Ferris has made it so dangerous for all of us that... Well, something ought to be done. Now, if he were to suddenly disappear, you understand?
Yes, we understand. You want us to get Ferris before Ferris gets you?
I am only warning you of your danger.
Of course, you wouldn't be guilty if complicit in putting Ferris out of the way.
That isn't the question. I'm simply trying to tell you...
Getting down to business. Where is he?
Ah, that is the point. Where is he? The rat keeps himself invisible. He directs his agents, but never appears on the scene himself. But a big job like getting the Palmer jewels ought to bring him personally on the ground. And if he should take to charge himself...
Listen, leave him to me.
Oh, yes. Leave him to him.
I thought so. Now, of course, I'm not suggesting what you are to do.
We understand perfectly. You always play safe. Have you got the money?
Ah, yes. Here it is. $3,000 in large bills.
Thank you.
You are a clever girl, Miss Carey. You understand. And I leave it all to you and Wilson.
Thank you. You always do leave it to someone else.
Excuse me, but I saw the Palmer car at the top of the hill. It is coming this way.
Your visitors? I shall be going.
That way is safer. You can cut through the garden. Tony will show you the way.
Goodbye and good luck.
Yes, here they come. And a swell car. There's something I want to say to you.
Yes?
If this frame-up goes through, and you're invited to that house, you'll be under the same roof with that Tom Palmer.
And all the Palmer jewels. Don't forget the jewels.
I ain't forgetting them, but you want to be almighty sure that you don't either.
What do you mean?
There's bigger game than diamonds to be played for.
Bigger game?
Yes, the biggest game of all. The man.
I? Play for a man? Don't be absurd.
Oh, you're clever enough. You're altogether too damn clever.
Besides, he doesn't want me.
I hope not, because somebody's going to be disappointed.
What are you hinting? What do you mean?
Just this. If you get into that house and that glib-tongued Lothario makes love to you, grab the stones and grab them quick, because you'll never get him. I'll get him first.
The Palmers!
All right, all right. I said all I gotta say.
They are coming round the bend.
All right. I'll be started before they get here. Where are they now?
Coming this way. Better begin to play.
I'm ready.
They are entering the gate. The Fortissimo! Fortissimo!
Mrs. Palmer.
Oh, Mrs. Palmer, I'm awfully glad you came. Won't you sit down? How are you, Grace?
Splendid, thank you.
And you? How are you?
Oh, fine.
But where is Mr. Palmer?
He was so sorry not to be able to come, but he had to go into town on business.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, let me introduce my music teacher, Professor Verdi. Professor, this is Mrs. Palmer. Miss Palmer?
Delighted.
Tom Palmer?
How do you do, sir?
We heard you as we entered the gate. I never knew, my dear, that you could play so well.
I have a very capable teacher.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Now, if you will remember not to slur in the andante and work gradually into the fortissimo, giving full expression to the arpeggio, you will produce a grand finale, and we will be a great success at the concert.
Concert?
At my studio. A private concert by my pupils. Miss Brockton is what you call, star pupil.
When does the concert come off?
Thursday evening.
As soon as that?
Well, that is why Senorita Brockton, she has much practice to do. Oh, here's Mr. Brockton.
How do you do, Mrs. Palmer? This is awfully good of you to come over. Glad to see you again, Miss Palmer. How are you, sir?
Oh, splendid, thank you.
Where is Mother? Mother wanted to ask you.
She'll be down in a moment.
Really, Mr. Brockton, how did you ever manage to get your place so well arranged in so short a time? Why, you've only been here. How long is it?
A month tomorrow.
Leave it to Brother Tom to keep tabs.
We took the house before Ruth and I sailed. And Mother, not sailing with us, enabled her to look after the furnishings. Ah! Here's Mother now.
Mrs. Palmer, allow me to present my mother, Miss Grace Palmer, and this is Tom Palmer.
So this is the Tom Palmer.
I hope there hasn't been another one coming around.
Real-life heroes are scarce.
There's one.
He? A hero?
I never saw a cooler man when he was needed.
Oh, I wasn't so cool, but seeing you.
When that ship struck that mine, believe me, I wasn't so cool either.
You were fortunate in remaining at home and missing it.
Yes, Mother missed the excitement, but she always did hate the water.
Oh, I just despise the ocean. It's the only thing that has kept me from going abroad. Wilson!
Wilson!
Mother, can I help you?
If you please, dear.
Mrs. Palmer, will you have lemon or cream?
Lemon, if you please.
And you, Grace?
The same, dear.
Permit me, senorita?
Wilson, you may pass the cake. How will you have yours?
Straight.
Oh, but this is tea.
Oh, I beg your pardon. A little lemon, please.
Lemon for you, Father?
Yes, dear.
That will do, Wilson. Dear, dear. A new man. I don't think he has had much experience.
One can't be too careful in the selection of servants these days.
Yes, Mrs. Palmer, you're quite right. The average servant is absolutely brainless.
Do you know, this doesn't seem like a first meeting at all to me. It's more like renewing an old acquaintance. I've heard so much of you. In fact, all Ruth has spoken about since she got back has been her friends, the Palmers.
I'm sure that's very kind of her.
I shall always be thankful to the good fortune that placed Ruth and my husband at the same table as you.
Then you should thank the purser.
The purser?
Oh, he got his reward. £5.
Who paid £5?
Why, the purser told us that you paid £5 for a seat at our table.
Did he tell you that?
Why, Father, you never told me.
Well, you see, it was this way. I didn't like the people at our table.
I'm glad of that.
No more than you like the people at your table.
Why? What do you mean?
You see, when Father and I decided to move to another table, we looked around the saloon and Father said, "Why, there are those nice-looking people we saw on the train to Cherbourg." And I said, "Yes, how nice would it be if we could sit at their table?" You see, I wanted to know you. All of you.
Why, isn't that strange? That's just what Tom said when he saw you on the train. That he wanted to know you. All of you.
But when we asked the purser for a seat next to you, he said he guessed it would be all right, seeing as you had paid him £5 for a seat next to us.
Well, yes, you see.
Why, this is quite remarkable. Well, sort of a mutual attraction.
Ah, yes, a mutual attraction. But we have another attraction. The view from the porch is simply magnifique. On a clear day like this, you can see above the trees, across the fields, so far as you can see the housetops of the big city.
Really?
Ah, it's wonderful. You must let me show you. I shall be honored. Will you not come too, madam?
I suggest that we all go out on the porch.
All right, Mother. That's a very good idea.
Don't you think we had better join the others?
No. Well, not until I've had a moment alone with you. Don't you know I haven't seen you for a whole week?
A whole week? My, is it as long as that?
You're looking wonderful. But you haven't said that you're glad to see me.
I thought you took that for granted.
I never take anything for granted.
Very well. How do you do?
Fine. Thank you.
I am glad to see you.
That's better. That's a whole lot better. Hello, hello. What a marvelous ring. By George, that's a beauty. Why, that fellow is a perfect 3-carat. I never saw him before.
All the jewels in the world aren't in the Palmer collection, you know.
It's wonderful.
Yes. I think it's rather pretty. Father gave it to me on my birthday. Do you know, with all your love for them, I've never seen you wear a jewel of any kind.
Oh, I hate to display in a man.
Why do you collect them?
For the same reason that other men collect wonderful paintings and beautiful statuary and rare pottery. You see, you really learn to know them and understand them. Precious stones, I mean. You discover in them the crystallized beauty of the world.
Tell me more about your collection. Remember, you were telling me the history of that wonderful necklace?
Yes, we were getting real chummy for the first time when we hit that confounded mine.
But speaking of jewels, have you added to the collection since you got back?
I haven't even looked at it. I haven't thought about anything or anybody, but you.
And thinking of me, and all the incidents of the voyage, didn't you wonder why Father would have paid the purser £5 for a seat next to you?
Not at all. Anything to get away from those long-bearded Russians. I couldn't have stood them myself.
You couldn't. But you did. You paid the purser £5 for a seat next to us.
Because I wanted to meet you. Why, I wanted to know you from the very moment our eyes met across the seat of that railroad car on the way to Charlebourg. Ruth, I...
Hadn't we better join the others?
Just a moment, Ruth. After all the things I said to you, you remember we sat on that deck with the moonlight on the water?
The things a man says under the influence of the moonlight on the water are best forgotten.
Ruth, don't you care? A little? Haven't my words meant anything?
A man's words mean so little.
Mine don't begin to express how much I care.
A man never really knows.
Yes, he does. When he hungers for the presence of a woman, when he thrills at the mere touch of her hand, when a wisp of her hair brushing his cheek sets his blood tingling, he knows he's met the one woman in the world for him.
She is always the one woman in the world. At the time.
Ruth, do you know sometimes I seem to feel you're merely playing with me.
No, I'm not playing with you. Really, I'm not. Oh, sometimes I wonder if you're really sincere.
I? Sincere? There are only some way of proving it. Test me. Test me any way you wish.
No, I don't want to. Really. Disappointments are always costly to a woman.
Here they are.
Yes, we were just going to join you, weren't we?
It's too late now.
It's commencing to cloud up, so we shall have to be going soon.
Please don't hurry.
Telegram for Mr. Brockton.
Excuse me. Oh, Mrs. Palmer?
Certainly.
My, my. This is unfortunate.
Why, what is it, Father?
Nothing serious, I hope.
Well, I'm afraid Ruth won't be able to play at the professor's concert.
Not play? Why? What has happened?
From Perkins, my lawyer in Chicago.
What does he say, Father?
Judge refuses further adjournment. Case on calendar for Wednesday. Will be absolutely necessary for you and Mrs. Brockton to be in Chicago Wednesday morning. You see, Mother and I are trying to recover some money we put into a venture.
But Miss Brockton, must she go too?
I hate to disappoint you, Professor, but...
After all the preparation, and she studies so hard, am I to lose my star pupil from my concert?
That is too bad.
Does the telegram say for Miss Brockton to go?
Well... We can't leave her alone in the house with the butler.
I can go to a hotel, Father.
I know, but a girl in a hotel, alone.
Ah, perhaps Miss Brockton, she has some friends with whom she can stay?
That would be all right, but we hardly know anyone in this section.
Let me offer a suggestion. If Miss Brockton doesn't have to go, I'm sure my mother and Grace will be delighted to have her as our guest.
Of course we shall.
It's very kind of you, but really, I couldn't think of inconveniencing you.
Inconvenience? Not at all.
But I'm sure I should only prove a nuisance. There's my music, and...
We shall enjoy hearing you play.
And there's Professor Verdi and my lessons.
Professor, you wouldn't object to giving Miss Brockton her lessons at our home, would you? It's such a little way from here.
Ah, certainly not. It would be just as convenient as coming here.
Then it's all settled. I'll fetch the car for you.
Are you sure I won't be in the way?
We should be offended if you refused.
It's satisfactory to you, isn't it?
Satisfactory? Oh, entirely so.
We are all delighted.
What time shall I call for you?
Mr. Palmer is speaking to you, dear.
What train will you take, Father?
The 20th century.
Then I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll motor down to New York with Father and Mother... Then I'll return to your house.
Good!
We shall expect you.
Tomorrow?
It's very kind of you.
Not at all. We're delighted to have Ruth with us.
We'll wire you when to expect us back.
Are you sure you don't want me to call for you?
I'll see Mother off and motor back in our car.
Just as you say. I'll see you tomorrow. Goodbye, Miss Brockton.
Goodbye. So glad you called.
Goodbye, Professor. Goodbye, sir. I hope you won your suit.
Thank you. I'll go as far as the door with you. Whew! They're gone!
It was perfect! Perfect!
We're in society, we are. I ought to paste this snow mat on the top of my head and stay in society.
Here you are, ladies. The booze am served.
Wilson, the new butler.
The frame-up worked, eh? Did it work? With Nan and the professor both on the inside. That's what I call finished work. Nan, you'll go down in history for this.
Yes. Dare I say, George, history isn't made until it's all over.
Yes, history is only for the dead ones.
Think of it, Nan. 500,000 worth of jewels in one clip. Do you know what this little enterprise is going to do? It will attach an imperishable luster to the name of Nan Carey. Nan, you'll be the Napoleon of crookdom. And if genius is to be commemorated to posterity, you'll have a tomb as big as Napoleon's.
What's that about the tombs?
There ain't no bail once you get into one of those tombs, he means.
Here's to Nan Carey, our incomparable leader.
I'm drinking, but we ain't got those stones yet.
Always shouting calamity, ain't you?
We ain't spending it yet.
I know how I'll spend mine.
Open a peanut stand, I suppose.
Peanuts? Bah.
Well, what would you do with it?
What shall I do? I'm rich. No more I take the chance. I live like the gentleman. I go to the opera, to the concert. I devote myself to my music.
That's a fine future for a wop crook.
You don't understand the soul of an artist.
I suppose you'll build a library or something like that?
No, I shall merely settle down and become a nice, quiet, hypocritical, law-abiding citizen.
My God, another good crick gone wrong. Nan, what are you dreaming about?
Oh, I was just thinking.
Building air castles, too.
I was just thinking, if we applied the same energy and resourcefulness and imagination to some honest pursuit...
Honest pursuit? That's only a matter of viewpoint.
Sure.
I know, George. But the world calls us crooks and we have no answer.
No answer? Here's our answer. The world calls us crooks, rogues, scoundrels, and we say to the world, what are you? In what way are you better than we are?
Yeah.
That's about right, yeah.
In what way is your scheming and conniving other than ours, though you practice as a lawyer, doctor, merchant, financier? What is your respectability but a cloak of deception? In fact, you are not as honest as we are, for we admit our dishonesty. No answer, eh? We say to all of them, go where you will, roam far and wide, but out of crookdom you will never be. For what is the world but an empire of fraud?
Bravo! Bravo!
Good, Georgie. You should have been a politician.
Yes, and he might have been, too, if he'd ever been able to live in one district long enough to have a vote.
Sit down, everybody. I want to talk to you. Boys, do you realize that we're on the eve of the biggest job ever pulled off in this country?
No, really?
What's that?
Well, we are. So, pay attention. The minute we get those jewels, we scatter for South America. George and Nell, you take the first boat direct for Rio Janeiro. Tony, you get there by way of Havana. Wilson, you travel by the way of New Orleans, and I'll follow the quickest way I can.
And who's going to carry the stuff?
None of us.
What?
None of us.
We're not going to leave it behind us, are we?
No, we are not. We'll let Uncle Sam take care of it for us and see that it's safely delivered.
Uncle Sam?
Yes, Uncle Sam, Nellie. Now here's my plan. We'll pack them in a nice little box and mail it to ourselves in Rio Janeiro, and we'll mail those, the Stuyvesant jewels, along with them. Now, is that satisfactory?
Tell me.
I don't know about that, Missy.
Mm-mm. Wait a moment. Remember this. The howl that went up after the Stuyvesant job won't be a whisper compared to the noise after the Palmer job is going to cause. They'll be searching for the stones all over, at every fence and every pawn shop and every jewelry merchant will be on the alert for them, just as they are for these. The minute one of those stones shows itself on the market up here, we're done for. And from now on, we have fares to deal with.
I'd take a long chance for just one crack at the guy.
Yes, you probably would. But the important thing is to beat it before he gets us. Now, here are my plans for Rio Janeiro. You, George, you're in the jewelry business. You are down looking over the ground to open a high-class jewelry store. Tony, you're down there to open a music studio. Wilson, you're looking for cheap lumber to export. And I'll be a tourist, traveling for my health. Is that understood?
Perfectly.
Now, tomorrow, George, Nell, and I will motor into town. While we're waiting for the 20th century to leave, we'll look after the transportation to South America. Then you and Nell come back here by way of the Harlem Division, and don't budge out of the house. Keep all the shades down. And Steve, you keep away from the shades. And Nellie, for pity's sake, pay no attention to the doorbell.
It can ring its head off for all I care.
Good. Now, Steve, there's a hedge, a very high hedge, across the way from the Palmer House. You hide behind it while Tony is giving me my music lesson. The moment we locate where the jewels are kept, Tony will play the signal on the piano. Let's hear it, Tony. That means we've located the stuff.
What do I do after that?
What do you do after that? Why, frame up something to get into the house to see me. Here, bring me my mesh bag that I'm supposed to have forgotten. That's good enough to get you in. I'll give you the layout of the house when you get there. Now, have you got that?
I'm over in the hedge while Tony is in the house. When I get the signal, then I come in to see you?
Good. That's right. Now you all understand clearly what you're to do?
I understand.
We got you.
Perfectly.
It's a cinch.
Then that's all there is to it.
That's all.
That's all.
Well, boys, it looks like a good day's work for us.
Dear, another moment in a room with her and I should have fallen on the floor from sheer dizziness.
Why, what's the matter?
Chatter, chatter, chatter. Nothing but questions from the moment she arrived. Good gracious, she's enough to drive one crazy. Just because her folks are going to build a new house when their present lease expires, she's preparing herself an architecture. So I had to tell her all about this place, describe every room in the house, every entrance and exit, where every hallway leads to, what's down in the basement, where do the servants sleep. By this time, I'd probably be deep in a description of the hardwood trimmings if I hadn't invented an excuse to get away.
I hope you weren't rude to her.
Oh, don't be alarmed. Tom's little romance won't suffer at my hands. Did you ever think, though, it was in him to grow so fond of any woman?
Oh, well, we're all human.
Hello, hello, where's our guest got to?
Our little guest is in her nest, dolling up for her host.
Where have you been?
In the garden.
Looking for a nice quiet nook in which to dream of future bliss with her?
Now what's the matter with you?
Oh, nothing that you could understand.
Now see here, Grace, I'm depending on you to make things pleasant for Ruth.
I've just had 3/4 of an hour with her, and I relinquish the chairmanship of the entertainment committee to you. Believe me, you'll find she doesn't grow on acquaintance.
Is that a fact? Well.
Hello, everybody. I hope I haven't kept you waiting long.
Hello, Ruth. I thought we had lost you.
I was lost. Out there. For the life of me, I couldn't find my way in that maze of corridors. Then I met Mr. Palmer and he showed me the way.
Yes, I was just starting out on my afternoon stroll and ran into Miss Brockton.
Oh, been wandering about the house?
Yes, trying to find my way, but that's nothing. My sense of direction always was poor.
Oh, I'm sorry, Miss Brockton. I was unable to pay my respects to your parents yesterday, but I hope to do so on their return. Did they get away safely this afternoon?
Yes. They must be well on their way to Chicago by now.
Mother, You must ask them over to dinner when they return.
The very first Sunday after they get back.
When do you expect them?
I can't say to that. Father promised to telegraph me.
Well, we'll try to keep you from getting too lonesome. How about it, Tom?
Oh, you leave that to me.
You'll see that you don't shirk the job. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'll go for my usual stroll before dinner. It's about the only exercise I get.
Don't forget, dinner will be served at 6:30.
I'll work up an appetite to remind me.
So long, Dad.
I'll be back in a little while. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Oh, I just love this house. It's just the sort of a house I've always wanted. And I shall instruct our architects to plan our home along the same lines. Before I leave, I'm going to ask you to show me through all of the rooms.
Tom, a call for volunteers. Do I hear any answer?
I am the official guide of this establishment.
That will be lovely, but I'm afraid my questions will tax my guide's patience. My experience with architects has been that they're stubborn as a mule about their own ideas. I'm going to prime myself with a lot of information about this establishment. You'll help me all you can, won't you?
Ask me anything you want to know, and if I can't tell you, we'll figure it out from the diagram.
The diagram?
The diagram of the house. It might be of help to you.
I'm sure it would.
The agent had it prepared for us. It shows the location of every room, its size, what it's used for.
Why don't you take it with you and show it to the architect?
Are you sure you can spare it? Really, I don't know how to thank you.
By making yourself entirely at home. Tell me, dear, did you find your room thoroughly comfortable?
Oh, yes. This will help me. Now, Mrs. Palmer, you won't mind my asking if it's all right to leave this around the room? I just brought it from the jeweler's.
Is it very valuable?
Two of my best pieces. I had them reset from gold to platinum.
You're perfectly right, dear, not to leave them about. It's never safe with servants in the house. Not that I think that ours are more dishonest than the rest of them, but it's foolhardy to throw temptation in people's way. Here, I'll put them with ours.
Thank you so much.
Tom, will you put it in the safe?
Immediately.
There's no hurry about it if it's going to put you to any trouble.
No trouble at all. The safe is right here. Now, watch.
Yes, I will.
What do you think of it?
What a clever idea. I should have never thought of looking for it there.
We used to keep our valuables in a safe deposit vault, but it was such a nuisance having to dash into town every time you wanted to wear any of them.
Don't you think this is much more convenient?
Oh, much more.
And they're just as safe.
Are they really?
It looks easy, but I'd like to meet the thief who can get into this box.
Really?
He'd never forget the experience if he survived.
If he survived?
I'll show you. You see this combination? Looks like nickel, but it's not.
It's solid copper.
Charged with electricity.
Touch it and you take hold of a live wire. We get the current from the heavy feed wire outside. Can you imagine the shock?
Yes, indeed. Can I imagine the shock? I should say I can imagine the shock. Wouldn't it be apt to kill?
Not instantaneously.
No.
But the torture wouldn't last over 10 minutes.
I see. Sort of a lingering death.
It might not prove fatal if the switch were turned off in time.
A switch?
You see, there's an alarm attached.
An alarm?
I'll show you. This is a rubber composition, but I'll be on the safe side. See, now it's entirely non-conducting.
My gracious!
I beg your pardon, sir.
It's all right, Phil. Turn off the switch.
Yes, sir. All the servants are at their places, sir.
Tell them it was merely a demonstration.
Yes, sir.
You see, dear, the servants are all drilled. The moment that bell sounds, every avenue is thoroughly guarded.
Oh, yes. I could see that. Quite an elaborate reception you've prepared. Is there anything else?
No, that's all.
That's enough. That's enough to discourage any burglar. I wish we had the same safeguards at home.
Why, my dear, you don't mean to say that you leave your valuables unprotected.
Oh, I'm not a bit uneasy about them. We have a secret hiding place. Someday I'll show it to you.
Now, any time you want them, just ask for them. No trouble at all to get them.
I can see that now. Really, I shall hate to tear them away from such good company.
Would you like to see our collection?
Would I like to see them? Nothing I'd like better.
Oh, Tom, some other time. I'm sure Ruth doesn't want to see them now.
I want her to see them now. Here, Grace. Here, Mother.
These are the emeralds.
These emeralds are larger.
Larger?
They're the diamonds and pearls.
Oh, diamonds and pearls. I adore diamonds and pearls. It's a heavenly combination.
Our pièce de résistance.
Oh, yes, we are very fond of that little piece.
It is the most magnificent thing I've ever seen. You must have had great trouble matching these pearls, the weight and the color. Oh, yes, indeed, it is very beautiful. I should be afraid to own it for fear of losing it. Did it cost a great deal?
Oh, about $50,000.
Oh, about $50,000.
Try it on, dear. It ought to be very becoming to you.
Really, I prefer...
I know Tom would love to see it on you.
Please, Ruth, as a favor to me.
Well, if you insist, as a favor to you. Oh, it's beautiful!
Professor Verity!
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Ah, pardon my being late. Dio! Wow, wow, wow!
Oh, evidently you admire precious stones, Professor.
Ah, jewels to me. They are the poetry of inanimate things. They sparkle. Oh, they dance with life and color. They fire my soul. They inspire me with music, or I cannot express it in words.
No, no, indeed. Never express it in words. Express it in music.
In music, yes. Music, ha!
What was that, Professor? I don't think I ever heard it before.
Something of my own composition.
What a catchy tune. Won't you play it for us again?
Do play it again.
Yes, and play it louder.
With pleasure. Si, senorita.
I beg your pardon, sir.
What is it?
A gentleman to see you, sir.
To see me?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Morton T. Hanley, Carnegie Hero Foundation. What does he want to see me about?
He says he has some news.
Oh, ask him to come in.
Yes, sir.
Would you rather go see him alone?
No, please don't go. It can't be anything important.
Mr. Hanley.
How do you do, sir?
Mr. Palmer.
That is my name.
I'm very glad to meet you, sir, especially under the circumstances which bring me here. As my card states, I represent the Carnegie Hero Foundation.
Won't you sit down?
No, thank you. I'm only staying for a moment.
Oh, Mr. Hanley, let me present my mother.
I am delighted, madame.
My sister, Mr. Hanley. Professor Verity.
How do you do, sir?
And Miss Brockton. Mr. Hanley.
Miss Brockton. Miss Ruth Brockton.
Do you know Miss Brockton?
Not personally, but her name is on my list. I was about to motor over to your house, Miss Brockton. We are gathering the testimony of the eyewitnesses to Mr. Palmer's valorous conduct on the occasion of the sinking of the passenger steamer, the Termania, with a view of awarding first prize, a gold medal for exceptional heroism.
You're not going to pin a Carnegie Hero Medal on me.
That is the object of my visit.
Honestly, I don't deserve anything like that.
Don't let him underestimate himself, Mr. Hanley. Why, during that panic, after that frightful explosion, in the wild rush for lifeboats, what chance would be the women and children have had it not been for him? Even with the crew fighting to save themselves, he stood against the rail, pistol in hand, holding back the infuriated mob, and when the last of the boat was launched, we saw him, master of the situation, resigning his own seat to a little boy who had been separated from his parents. When that ship went down, if it hadn't been that the sea was calm and we saw him clinging to a log, he too would have been lost.
Oh, Miss Brockton, your statement completes our record of the disaster. If you will be so good as to write out what you've just said, attest it before a notary and mail it to us, the medal will be quickly awarded.
I will be glad to do so.
Thank you. We will appreciate it. Oh, by the way, Mr. Palmer, someday when you get a chance, you must visit our office and examine the tributes of your fellow passengers. Why, there are statements from some of the most prominent people of the country. There's one from Dr. Holt that will do you good to read. If we didn't know that Dr. Holt was Mr. Carnegie's personal physician, we'd suspect of his motive. And you ought to read the statement from Mr. Pearson, the president of the Union National Bank. Oh, but the clearest account of all we received from a detective. Ferris.
Ferris? Ferris? I don't recall the name on the passenger list. Do you, Mother?
No.
He may have traveled incog. Detectives often do, especially when they're after somebody.
Have you seen Mr. Ferris?
No. No, not personally.
Is he in the city?
Well, that I don't know. I called at his office this morning. One of his assistants told me Mr. Ferris was after an extremely clever gang of criminals against whom he had been gathering evidence for the past 5 months. He expects to land them all by the end of the week. Then, I'm to have an interview with him.
Well, please convey my thanks to Mr. Ferris, Dr. Holt, Mr. Pearson, and all the others.
I shall be pleased to do so. And I hope shortly to have the honor of witnessing the formal presentation of the medal. We hope to hear from you shortly. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Oh, let me show you the way.
We mustn't keep you from your music lesson any longer. I know the professor is getting impatient. Come, come.
All right, Mother.
Don't forget Grace. Bridge later.
I know, dear. See you later.
Ferris! He followed you over on the boat! Why, that means he's laying a trap for us! And everything was just coming our way!
Tony, wait a minute.
What are we going to do?
Get those jewels out of that safe tonight.
Huh. Regardless of Ferris?
Regardless of everything.
But if Ferris trailed you on the boat, it is certain that he knows that we are in here and why we are here. Suppose he gets us while we're pulling off the job.
We won't be any worse off than we are now.
What do you mean?
Two of the stuyvesant pieces are in that safe.
Oh, Dio! Why, that is more than plenty to convict us all. And you have them, the evidence, yourself. Oh. I just thought of something. Suppose that Ferris, he tipped off Mr. Palmer, told him that you were a crook, that everything you do is simply to rob him. Suppose he tells him that and induces Mr. Tom to trap us?
Tony, don't. It's terrible. Isn't that funny? That same thought just crossed my mind. Why, their readiness in showing me the safe, the combination. Why are they so free with their confidences? Parading the jewels before me? The more I think about it, the more significant it looks.
Ah, Ferris! Ferris! Over 500 people go down on that boat, and it's our misfortune to have him saved.
Oh, I wonder what kind of a game he's trying to play on us. He seemed sincere enough. Come in.
I beg your pardon, Miss Brockton. Your butler is calling. He says you forgot to bring your mesh bag. Shall I take it?
No, just have him bring it in.
Yes, ma'am. This way.
You overlooked this, Miss Brockton, so I took the liberty of bringing it over. I got the signal!
All right. Here's the layout of the house.
Why, how did you...
Never mind how I got it. There's no time to explain now. Here's my room. Two flights up. The first two windows from the front. Both of you will be in the hedges at midnight. When you see me wave a handkerchief in front of the window, you come in by way of the balcony.
All right, but where's the little box?
Behind that panel, and as easy as opening a can of sardines.
Watch. Wait a minute. Steve, that combination is charged with electricity. That was the switch. Whatever you do, Be sure to turn off the juice before monkeying with the combination.
You bet I won't forget that little thing.
Now, another thing. I want all of you to come over in the car, a little before midnight. Nell and George are to stay in the car about a mile down the road. And above all, have everything ready in case we have to make a quick getaway. Now, is that clear?
I got you.
Put this in your pocket. If anything happens to change the plans, I'll get word over to you and Tony.
Well, you'd better see that nothing does happen.
What do you mean?
I mean that any interference, especially from him, well, I'm not taking any chances tonight.
Don't pull that tonight. Don't forget that in anything you do, we're your accomplices. Do you want us all to be taken for murder?
Well, you know my sentiments. I thought you might need it.
Thank you, Wilson. It was very thoughtful of you.
I hope I haven't butted into anything.
Not at all.
I didn't hear any music, so I thought perhaps you'd postpone the lesson.
Yes, Miss Brockton. She feels fatigued today. She has been working so... I return tomorrow.
Won't you stay for dinner?
Oh, thank you. I should feel highly honored, but unfortunately I have another appointment, so I will have to ask you to excuse me this time.
Then perhaps some other time.
Some other time? I shall be most delighted. I hope you're better tomorrow. Au revoir! Au revoir!
He's a peculiar little fellow, isn't he?
Yes, isn't he?
So, you like our house, eh, Ruth?
Why, I just love it. Anyone with half an eye must admire the way everything is arranged. Tell me, how did you come to select this place?
I saw it advertised in one of the papers. After living most of our lives in the West, we couldn't get used to those cubbyhole apartments in New York. But, do you know, I don't much care for this place.
Don't you like it? I think it's so comfortable, so roomy.
It's neither city nor country, it's just suburban. The only thing that's kept me here since we got back has been you.
I?
Yes, I'd have been at Palm Beach by now. I only stayed on because of the chance to be near you.
Then, except for me, you'd have found it rather dreary up here.
What's there up here for anybody? Oh, I hate the city and its whole environment. Even in its merriment, there's always something shrill and harsh. Haven't you found it so?
Yes. I wish I could get away from here myself.
I wish we were far away from here, down south, among the flowers and the light of the tropical sun. Haven't you dreamed of that brightness?
Yes. I have dreamed of it often, and I've thought a lot, too, of the shock of awakening.
Ruth, I love you so devotedly, there's nothing in the world I wouldn't do for you. Nothing I wouldn't give you, nothing I want to do except devote myself to your happiness. Ruth, dear, will you be my wife?
Your wife?
Yes, we could be married and go away tomorrow or tonight. We can't get away from here too soon to suit me.
How can you think of leaving so abruptly?
What is there up here for me except you?
Why this pressing anxiety?
Ruth, I just feel I can't live another day without you. Just tell me that you love me, that you care.
I can't tell you that now. No, I haven't the right to.
No, right to? Why not?
No. No, I haven't the right, Tom. Suppose I had kept something hidden from you. Suppose there was something in my past.
Oh, don't be ridiculous, Ruth. What can there be in a past of a girl like you? At the worst, some girlish prank that looks appalling to you but doesn't amount to shucks.
What do you regard as merely a childish prank?
I haven't the faintest idea what's lurking in that terrible past of yours, but no matter what it is, it can't make any difference to me. I'd take you if, instead of the best, you were the worst woman in the world. No matter what you were, what you had done, it couldn't alter my feelings for you. All I want is to hear you say that you'll marry me. Ruth, will you?
Tom. Oh, I wish I just wish you hadn't asked me. It makes it so difficult. It makes everything so hard. And I can't explain. I can only say I can't do it. No, I can't marry you now.
Not marry me? Is it because you don't care?
No. It isn't that. It just can't be. That's all.
Can't be? In only a moment, I felt so sure of you. Have I been a fool and taken things for granted? I have felt as if I had your promise.
Was it from anything that I have ever said?
Oh, a girl doesn't have to say it. There are unspoken promises on which others build, and the disappointment hurts. Yes, Ruth, it hurts.
Tom, I'm sorry if I've ever done anything to hurt you. I'm so very, very sorry. I wouldn't hurt you for anything in the world.
You see, Mother, I wasn't late for dinner after all.
Hello, where's the professor?
I saw the professor leaving, so I supposed the lesson was finished.
I hope we haven't interrupted anything.
Not one little thing.
Dinner will be served in 10 minutes.
10 minutes? I must hurry. I want to dress up for dinner. Will you excuse me?
Don't hurry, dear. A few minutes won't make any difference.
Say, Grace told me about Ferris. How the devil did he get onto us?
How did he locate us?
What's the difference now? Are we going to stick around here till he gets us?
Why, by this time he's probably connected us with every job we ever pulled off.
My God, after waiting around all this time, are we going away with only 2 of her pieces?
Listen, we followed you here from the west because you said the picking was better. Well, we haven't picked up a damn thing since we've been here, and now we're liable to be picked up ourselves.
Yes, and we've just been eating our heads off for a crack at those Brockton stones.
I had my eye on that pearl necklace from the first time I saw Mrs. Brockton wear it. It must be worth $30,000 at the least.
And between her and Ruth, they've worn over $20,000 worth of other junk. Are we going to leave that behind?
Why, it would be like making them a present of it.
Yes, and all because of your love affair. Oh, you needn't look at me like that. I heard you asking her to marry you. Why, you poor boob. What chance do you think you've got with her? If she doesn't know you're a crook, she will know it. And then what'll she do? Why, she'll run from you like she was escaping from a wild animal.
What are you going to do?
Yes, come on, let's have a showdown.
What are we going to do?
What the hell do you think we're going to do? Phil, you and I clean out the Brockton house tonight.
What about me?
You stay here and look after the women.
Good. Have you located where they keep the stuff?
No, and I don't have time to find out. She dropped a hint that the stones were all there, and I know there's no one in the house except that butler. If he won't tell willingly where the treasure chest is, I guess we know how to make him.
What's the dope after we get the stones?
South America, Buenos Aires. Now, sit down, all of you. Now, we're going to be nailed from the moment one of those stones shows its face on the market up here.
You can bet we are.
The war closes Europe, but there's lots of rich schmucks down in South America, and they're getting richer every day. So, we get ready to scatter the minute we pull off the job.
Who's going to take charge of the swag?
None of us.
What?
We'll pack it in the box and ship it express to Rio Janeiro. All right?
I should say no.
Get out of our hands.
In case of trouble, we don't want it found on us, do we?
I guess you're right.
Now, you and Grace travel by way of Frisco. Phil, you and Ed go by way of New Orleans. I'll follow by way of Panama. To avoid suspicion, you and Grace are a couple of tourists traveling for your health. Phil, you and Ed are sent down here to look over the cattle country, and I'll go down and open a first-class jewelry store. Now, have you got that in your heads?
I understand.
Thank heaven we get away from here at last.
You've said something.
Well, that's all there is to it.
That's all.
I hope so.
Well, it looks like a good day's work for us. Put up your hands!
What's the idea?
No, you don't. Keep them up.
You. I got it. That's the frame-up, eh? She sent you for them, did she?
Yeah, she sent me. See if he's got a gun.
Automatic. 1916 model.
He believes in preparedness. Now listen, we're here strictly on business, and we're in an awful hurry. So answer us the briefest you know how. Where's the rest of them?
Go look for them yourself.
Shh, now be a good boy, unless you want to make business for the Undertaker.
Say, what are you gonna do with them?
Put the muffler on him.
Throw up your hands. We'll take charge of those just to avoid accidents. Tony, get his gun. Wilson, get his. Now stand away from that table.
Why, George, what was all that noise about? You...
How do you do, Miss Brockton?
Now, what's the meaning of this?
I suppose we're all wondering what we're doing here. Well, it's easily explained. Miss Brockton has worried about her jewels and sent us to fetch them.
What?
What?
Luckily, we got here just in time to discover him ransacking the house.
Yes, in another minute, he'd have been on his way with them.
You say that Ruth sent you for them?
Yes, and I'm glad for her sake that we arrived when we did.
Why, damn you, didn't you?
Stay where you are. I'm taking charge of this. Strange we didn't hear you coming. Isn't it customary on entering a house to ring the bell?
Naturally. But you see, we didn't expect to find you home. We thought you were on your way to Chicago.
Yes, so we were. But we were intercepted at Albany by a telegram saying the case had been postponed. Didn't Ruth receive our wire?
No, I'm quite sure she didn't.
Then I'd better call her up at once. What's your number?
133.
Hello? 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 I don't seem to be able to get an answer. Why, the wires have been disconnected.
Maybe someone cut the wires.
It wouldn't surprise me in the least. Isn't that the first thing they usually do? Before we're through, the chances are we'll find this man is a dangerous criminal. My car is outside. Don't you think I'd better go for the police?
We won't be in any hurry about the police. It might be wiser first to hear what Ruth has to say. Don't you think so, Mother?
By all means. I always hate any dealings with the police.
Perhaps you're right. We can't get away, and there's no haste about deciding what to do with them. So, come on, Phil. We'll drive Miss Brockton right over.
Oh, before you go, hadn't you better let me have the key to the house?
The key?
Yeah, if Ruth sent you for the jewels, she must have given you the key.
Yes, she did give it to me, but the fact is I misplaced it. I thought I had it in my pocket. I never missed it until I got here. That's always the way. You never do miss a thing till you try to find it.
Well, how did you get in?
I must explain. Miss Brockton had a premonition about this fellow. And when we arrived, I saw a light through the shade and a figure moving about. Of course, I wasn't sure what was going on, but I decided if he was up to anything, I'd catch him unawares. And having misplaced the key, we came through the window.
Do you often enter houses that way?
Are you intimating?
Nothing. I am intimating nothing. But the fact remains that we found you covering our butler with a gun.
I told you, we caught him
robbing the house. Yeah, that's what you said. And you overpowered him, and we're going to deliver him to the police. That's all very well, but it just happens that we sent him downstairs for the jewels, and he was about to bring them up to us when you intercepted him.
Oh, well, I didn't know that. Of course, that puts an entirely different complexion on it. Naturally, when I saw him taking the valuables, I jumped at the conclusion and acted accordingly. Wilson, I offer an apology, and I'm glad to learn that you are a faithful and trustworthy servant. I shall report to Miss Brockton that her fears were entirely unfounded.
Now, hold on a minute. Let's clear this up.
By all means, but isn't everything explained?
How do you explain the gag in Wilson's mouth?
The gag?
Did you gag him for fear that he might yell out and bring the police or neighbors down on him?
Maybe he is afraid I was going to bite him.
Yes, of course, I wanted to prevent him from crying out. How did I know that he didn't have Confederates lurking about? They might have come in and overpowered us. Isn't that perfectly clear?
That does sound reasonable. But not that we doubt your word, Mr. Palmer. But after all, it seems very extraordinary to me that Ruth should have sent you for her jewels.
Yes, it does seem rather extraordinary.
I grant you it is unusual, and I don't blame you for your doubts. Therefore, I again volunteer to fetch Miss Brockton myself.
That's very sweet of you, but we won't put you to so much trouble. You say your car's outside?
Yes, a short distance down the road.
Huh. Well, Wilson is a very capable driver, and with your permission, we'll borrow your car. 11 o'clock. We can make it easily in 5 minutes.
Now, wait a minute. I don't mind lending the use of my car, but I resent your manner of taking it. You found me here under rather peculiar circumstances, and I submitted myself to your questions. Now, you can believe me or not, just as you like, but I shall not remain under this roof another instant, and I forbid you from taking my car.
We have one of our own, but tonight we prefer to use yours, and until you return, I must insist upon the pleasure of your society.
Do I understand I am virtually a prisoner?
No, just a guest from whom we are most reluctant to part. And to prove our eagerness for your society, we're going to keep you with us a little while. Now, be a good boy, and remember, we're in an awful hurry tonight.
Is this a joke? Or what are we up against?
Better submit quietly.
What's all this for, anyway?
We want to hear you say, in Ruth's presence, that she sent you for the jewels. You don't mind confronting her, do you?
Why, damn you!
Look out!
Wait, Phil, put it down! Put it down. What's the use? They've got us. If you're going all the way over to my place just to ask Miss Brockton whether she sent me or not, I can save you all the trip. She doesn't know we're here.
What?
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 You'll get it from her, so I might as well tell you now. I tried to bluff it through as long as I thought that there was a chance of us making a getaway. But you're too many for us, and you control all the ammunition. We came here for the stuff. There's $500,000 worth of stuff in my house for which I'm wanted in half a dozen states. You see, I'm not trying to make it easy for myself. But I want you to consider that you haven't lost anything, and if you deliver me to the bulls, it means a stretch for every job. And that means life.
Why, they're a couple of crooks.
That's what they are. Now, who'd ever guessed it? Why, the idea. The very idea. How dare you outrage our hospitality as you have done, worming your way into our peaceful little home?
Why, Hane is too good for a guy like him.
I guess you're right. And you don't think any less of me than I think of myself. There's only one thing I ask. Whatever you decide to do with me, for heaven's sake, do it before Miss Brockton sees me. That's the thing I can't stand. Face her.
Hey there!
Look out!
He nearly got away that time.
What'll we do with him?
Verdi, put him in there. Wilson, put him, in there.
Get in there.
Swells, my gracious, you can't tell in this world anymore who is respectable.
That's right. Whew. But for a little while there, Nell, he had me believing that Ruth was double-crossing us.
Now be a good boy.
Did you tie them up?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, lock the doors and give me the keys.
Well, let's get on the job.
Yes, where's the kit?
Here it is.
How do we work?
The same as usual. Wilson and you on the inside. Nell and I will be the lookouts.
Swells, eh? Now we can go over to that Palmer house, clean them out, and they daren't even make a squeal.
Not even a squeak. It certainly looks as if we were playing on the side of Providence tonight. Go on, boys.
Tom! Why, what are you doing here?
They got me, that's all. I thought no one was home but the butler, but your people came back unexpectedly. They're on their way to fetch you before turning me over to the police. Now do you understand why I came in here?
You mean you came here to rob the house?
Yes.
Who emptied the lamp?
Oh, they're safe enough. Your people took them along with them.
My people?
They must have. I left them on the table. Now that you know what I came in here for, what are you going to do with me?
What do you want me to do?
Untie my hands?
No. Oh, no. No, no.
Thanks. That feels better. I've got a pal in there, too, tied up.
Please, wait a moment. Please.
I've got to do some fast traveling tonight.
Wait a moment, please. Isn't there anything you want to say to me?
What's the use? It's all over. And you'd only despise me all the more if you heard me pleading the baby act.
Haven't you one word to say in extenuation?
As my own lawyer, I don't know a decent thing I could say for my client. You see, I went wrong a year after I came out of college. Gambling started me, and the first successful job I pulled finished me off. I always sort of eased my conscience by saying that when thousands have so little, it's no crime to take it from those who have so much. I sort of talked myself into believing it, too. Yes, and I'd have gone on believing and acting on it, but you, well, you sort of carried me back to the days when I was different.
Then why did you do this tonight?
Why did I do it? Because I knew that if I didn't come in here myself, the others would have come in without me.
Others?
Listen, Ruth, the woman you met as my mother isn't my mother. She was the cleverest confidence woman in the West. Grace isn't my sister. She and Phil, the man who acted as a butler, are married. We're all in the same combination. You probably wouldn't understand this.
Oh, no!
But when you join a syndicate like ours, you cease to be a free agent. You deliver yourself into the hands of your pals. Once I got them started on this job, I had to play along with them because they hate a quitter. And any one of them could have won immunity for himself by squealing on me. But I want you to know that after I got to caring for you, I stalled and stalled on this job, hoping something would happen to spoil it. And I've kept on stalling, but for that Carnegie Metal man mentioning the name Ferris today. Of course, the name Ferris doesn't mean anything to you, but to us, it was like a bombshell dropped out of the sky. It was up to us to clean up and clear out.
I see. That's why you were so urgent to have me go away with you tonight?
Yeah, I realized it was tonight or never.
Tom, if I had said yes, would you really have allowed me to go with you?
No, Ruth. Not until you had a fair chance to reconsider. Because in that case, I'd have told you everything before you started. You see, I made up my mind to leave everything behind but you. I intended on starting all over again, and I would have gone straight.
I wonder.
I know it's hard to believe, but I could be so contemptible with you at my side.
But Tom, suppose that now I were to reconsider? That now I were to say yes?
After what I did to you? After the way I tried to double-cross you? I'd say you were making fun of me.
But if I convinced you that I meant it? If I had reasons of my own for wanting to go away with you? I do care for you. I do.
No, Ruth. I love you too much to let you do a thing like that. Ruth, the chances are we'll never see each other again. But I want to tell you that, in a decent way, you've been the biggest thing in my life.
Thank you. Go in there quick, and don't make a sound. Ira, for heaven's sake, what brings you up here at this hour of the night?
You've got to hide me till I can make a getaway. They're looking for me. I've been indicted.
What? Indicted? Is it anything in which we're concerned?
I don't know the particulars. I got a tip from a friendly court clerk while they were out making the warrant. I've been keeping out of the way, manipulating underground wires for information. All I could get was that the information came from Ferris.
Ferris?
Yes, I told you that wolf had his teeth set for me. Where's the rest of the gang?
They're pulling off the Palmer job now.
Oh my God, that's what I wanted to stop. I didn't want anything pulled off until I found out what Ferris had on me.
On you?
Yes, there's been a leak somewhere. Treachery. And if he connects me with this job...
Oh, here you are. He didn't expect to ever catch up with you after double-crossing us.
Double-cross? She?
We got there just as arranged, but not a sign of her. Well, Tony and I decided to take a chance. We went in, we opened the safe, and found it empty.
Wait a moment there.
Look at them. What did I tell you? They had it all fixed to make a getaway and leave us flat.
Isn't it about time we retreated to an explanation?
Those jewels were not in the safe.
Where are they?
Where are they? Do you recognize them?
Holy Moira! We've been robbed!
How did you get to them?
Thanks to you, Mr. Palmer. Once to the left, twice to the right, three times to the left, and open.
Why? What's it mean?
It means this isn't my mother, and this isn't my father, and we're all members of a combination just like yours.
My God, they're a gang of crooks. Why, Ruth, we're pals. There's been a mistake all around.
Sure, the next thing we know, we'll all be apologizing to each other.
Apologize? Nothing. I tell you, if we don't get out of here pretty quick, Ferris will get the whole lot of us.
Yeah, it isn't very healthy up here for us. We were figuring on getting away from here tonight.
So were we. Where were you going?
South America? Buenos Aires?
We selected Rio Janeiro.
Why? We'd have been neighbors again, wouldn't we?
There's the door. Get out.
Goodbye, Mr. Palmer.
What do you mean goodbye? Say, you don't think you're going to separate those from me, do you?
My dear boy, we wouldn't think of allowing you to risk your liberty by being caught with the goods.
Well, we'll take that chance.
What's the good of separating? Here we are, two clever mobs. Why not follow the methods of the big financiers and consolidate? Why, a combination like ours couldn't be beaten.
Maybe he's right. With a couple of leaders like him and Nan, we could put all the other crooks out of business. There wouldn't be anything left for them to steal.
Now listen, I go into no more combinations.
Now, wait a minute, Steve. The tendency of modern business is toward a consolidation and the elimination of rivals. It might be to our mutual advantage to form a little trust of our own. What do you think about it, Ira?
I'm not thinking anything but to get away from here.
Now listen, all of you, let's take a sensible view of this. If we go off with their property, you couldn't blame them for squealing and making a deal with Ferris. If they took ours, I know we'd go a long way to be avenged. Remember, Ferris would make pretty near any kind of a deal to recover this stuff. I'd say it's up to us to get together.
I second the motion.
I am willing to consolidate.
I'm solid for it.
So am I.
Well then, bring up some chairs and we'll talk it over.
I tell you, it's dangerous. It's dangerous. I refuse to participate.
I know. Playing safe again, Ira. If you want to go, go ahead.
Very well. Give me my share.
Give you nothing. If you want to freeze yourself out, that leaves one less to divide with.
Why, it's just like a director's meeting, isn't it?
Let's get this through quickly.
You're a lawyer, Ira. What's the first step in forming a combination?
Yes, let's do it legally.
It would seem to me the first thing to do would be to ascertain what each side has to offer. Now, I consider these to be worth $250,000. What do you consider those to be worth?
$500,000.
That makes our contribution worth $750,000. Now, what have you have to offer?
Why, we're putting these in.
You're putting them in? Well, you've got a hell of a nerve. Them's ours.
Of course they are.
They were ours the day we went after them.
Aw, say, cut out this kidding. That's our stuff. Give it to me.
Put him down.
Wait a minute. We'll never get anywhere if we're going to have dissension.
What are you trying to do? Disrupt the combination already?
From now on, we'll cut out the gunplay. Steve, give it to me.
What?
Go on, Steve.
Give me yours, Tony.
Go on, Tony.
All right.
Ira.
Go on, Ira. Now, if this is going to be a gentleman's agreement, let's all act like gentlemen.
That's right, George. Give me yours.
Go on, George.
Now we'll get these out of the way.
Now we'll proceed with the preliminaries in a decorous way.
I guess that means you two thieves.
Oh, what's the use of wasting time? I move that we proceed on a 50-50 basis. Are all you willing?
Well, I don't like I don't the sound of that, that one whoa, bit. Whoa, whoa, as a matter whoa, of fact, whoa. I Come feel on, as a musician, I bring a great level of...
My God, the coppers!
Throw up your hands and don't make any bust away. The house is surrounded, and my men have orders to shoot to kill. Now line up there, the whole lot of you.
Move over there.
Come on.
Bill, Charlie, Jim, frisk 'em.
Keep your mouths shut, everybody. Remember, anything you say may be used in evidence against you.
Oh, you know the law, don't you? Mooney, guard that door. Bill, guard that door. No, you don't. Put 'em up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 of 'em. Pipe the sparklers. Must be pretty near $1 million worth of stuff. Well, boys, it certainly looks like a good day's work for us.
Ah! Jupiter! I'm stiff from sitting here all night. Sacre dia dio!
Say, what are you trying to do, break up the furniture?
If they are going to keep me here any longer, I shall insist on being made comfortable.
Sure, ask them and maybe they'll move in a piano for you.
Good morning, everybody!
Oh, go to hell!
What's the matter? Didn't you sleep well? Boys, let them have some sunlight.
How long are you going to keep us here? This isn't a police station. This is the office of a private detective agency. You haven't any right to hold us here.
Well, maybe you're right. But the next stop is police headquarters. Are you in a hurry to get there?
No, I ain't in any hurry.
Nah, not me. I'm all right here.
If we are under arrest, I demand to know the nature of the charge against us.
Under arrest? Who said you were under arrest?
What?
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 What are you talking about?
What?
If you'd been under arrest, we'd have been compelled to deliver you to the nearest police station. You're down here by special invitation.
Oh, ain't that nice.
Certainly you're not under arrest.
Well, in that case, if we're not pinched, come on, boys.
But I'd advise you not to leave.
I demand to know by what authority my home was broken into last night and my property seized. If that was some of Ferris's work, I'll hold him personally responsible.
And what right had your men to invade my home last night?
Yes, and drag us down here.
And treat us like a lot of common criminals.
And furthermore, where is Miss Brockton?
Yes, where is Miss Brockton?
If she's being detained at all.
Well, what are you going to do about it?
What are we going to do about it? Why, habeas corpus is my breakfast food.
What do you think bluffing is going to get you? Why, you haven't got a chance in the world to beat this. Now, if you'd act sensible and come through like the other one.
The other one? What do you mean?
You can bank on it. In every gang of crooks, there's always one squealer.
He means Nan.
Do you?
Well, you can draw your own conclusions.
Do you think you can put anything like that over on us?
What do you take us for? A lot of boobs?
Why, you can't convince us that Nan's a... Well, that she'd lie to us.
Yes, certainly. Besides, what is she to tell? We haven't done anything. We're innocent.
Sure, we're innocent.
You're sure a fine lot of innocent-looking babies you are. Hello? Who wants Ferris? The district attorney? All right, I'll talk to him. Hello? Oh, how are you, Mr. Andrews? No, this is Holmes talking. I'm sorry, but Ferris is engaged. Can I take a message? Why, Ferris is taking down her statement now. No, Nan is the one. Nan, the leader of the Brockton gang. Yes, she's spilling it now. Yes, sir. We'll shoot the confession over to you as soon as she signs it. Yes, I'll tell Ferris at once. All right, Bill. All right, Jim. Now I'm gone. Behave. Be good boys.
I told you so. When a gang like ours starts to drink and tea, something awful is bound to happen.
You don't believe she's squealing, do you?
Well, of course not. It's all perfectly obvious. That telephone talk was exclusively for our benefit.
Say, listen.
You can't convince me that Nan would sacrifice us to save herself.
I ain't so sure about that.
Why ain't she here with us?
How do we know what she's doing now? How do we know that she ain't with Ferris right now, spilling everything to him?
If we go up for this, it's your fault. If you hadn't stuck around to bill and coo with her, we'd have been safely away from here long ago.
Yes, we can blame you for this. I told you not to linger.
You knew Grace and Phil wanted to start housekeeping, and I was going to retire with them.
Yes, we were to retire too.
Cut it out. We're a couple of wise mobs, we are. And with two leaders like him and Nan, we could put all the other crooks out of business, eh? There wouldn't be anything left for them to steal. Why, say, we couldn't even trim each other.
Say, Aw, shut up.
Oh, what a sweet and amiable mood we're all in today.
Well, whose fault is it if Nan squealed on us?
It's your fault, Lazar.
Mine?
Yes. You sent her to us. You vouched for her.
Now listen. Are we going to fall for that bull's frame-up? Are we going to take his word that Nan has turned traitor? Why, she couldn't be such an ingrate.
Ingrate?
Yes, ingrate. Where do you think she was when I first met her? Locked up in the tombs for shoplifting.
Shoplifting?
Can she be so ungrateful as to forget that I took her case for a paltry $50? Can she forget the day I had her acquitted and she sat in my office weeping tears of gratitude? And who helped her when she didn't have a nickel? Can she forget that she might have been walking the streets if I hadn't staked her? And who raised her from a piking shoplifter to going after the big swag? I put her with George and Nell and Tony. She can't forget that. No. No bull can make me believe that she's going to bite the hand that fed her.
Poor girl. I hate to think of the third degree.
There ought to be a law abolishing that third degree.
Come on, let's buck up. What's the use of crossing bridges before we get to them?
Yes. It's more than an even chance that we'll beat this case. And if we all stand pat, we haven't played our trump card yet.
Listen, if you've got anything bigger than a deuce in the hole, I'd like to see it.
Well, here's our ace. Are you sure that all your stuff was broken up and the stones reset?
Positive. Not a single stone was left in its old setting.
Good. How about yours?
Every last one of them was reset.
That's our salvation.
What do you mean?
Don't you see? Ferris represents the burglary insurance companies. Now, what's worrying the companies most? How to recover the property on which they must have paid out close to $1 million. How many of the original owners do you think will recognize their stuff in the new settings? Not 5% of them. That's why Ferris wants us to think that Nan has squealed. Now, for heaven's sake, everyone sit tight and the companies will be more than willing to make terms with us. I'll do all the talking.
Well, what do you think you have been doing?
Now, another thing. We've got to get Nan and get to her quick. They'll resort to anything to break her down, but if she'll hold out...
Shh! He is Nan! Now, will you identify them? I'll call them off in the order in which they are named in this confession.
What?
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 What? What?
Ira Lazar?
Ira Lazar?
That's a lie. I'm innocent. I tell you, I'm innocent.
Take him away, boys.
Not a word. Don't say a word. Remember, they'll use it against you.
Mrs. Nellie Brockton?
Nellie?
After all we did for you, taking you into our home and making you feel like one of us, you repay us by turning squealer. You're a... Well, that's what you are.
George Brockton.
George Brockton.
Huh. You're not fit to associate with honest crooks.
Mrs. Palmer and Grace Palmer.
Come on, Grace. You shameful little hussy.
You dirty little cat.
Ed Palmer.
Ed Palmer.
Antonio Verdi.
Tony.
Phil Preston. Steve Wilson.
Steve.
Nan, don't be hard on a guy. Why, we've been pals for 5 months. Why did you... By God, I'd swing to get you. Hey, cut that rough stuff. What's the matter with you? Cut it out, I tell you. Let me get my collar and necktie on.
Tom Palmer.
I'd like to speak to Tom Palmer.
I want to see Ferris.
You do, eh? Well, you stay here.
I would rather wait somewhere else.
You stay here.
Ruth, how could you? I wouldn't have cared if it had been anybody but you. God, I'm disappointed.
Tom, why did you ask to see Ferris?
Because I thought I might be able to make a deal with him that would help the others. I thought if he was on that boat, he might feel kindly towards me. I want to see him, talk to him, and tell him if he would just let up a bit. On the others, I'd take a plea, and they could hand me the limit. You see, I made up my mind yesterday if it ever came to a showdown, I'd do everything I could to make it easy for them. And you.
I had made up my mind, too, that I was going to do everything I can to make it easy for them. And you.
You mean, you sacrificed yourself for us?
Don't you see it even now?
See what?
Everything that has happened since the first day I met you. The series of events leading up to the arrest. That the raid could have taken place just after I had relieved you all of your guns.
It means you've been working for Ferris all the time?
No. It means that I'm in business for myself.
Yourself? Then you're...
Ferris.
Of course! Of course, by Jove, it all comes back to me now. Everything you did, all you said was merely to ensnare me and to trap the others. I suppose we'll all be looking out from behind bars and finding you laughing at us down the corridor. It'll bring a lot of glory to you, getting us 20 years apiece. So it makes no difference what we think of you. But I want to say this. You've stooped pretty low. Lower than any of us would have ever done. Even for a crook, I can feel contempt for.
Tom.
Yes, it was contemptible for you to do it. Gee, I'd have gone through for you.
Yes, and I'm going through for you.
What do you mean?
Listen, Tom. I started out on this case with every intention of going through. I didn't seek the job. The job sought me. I was a reporter getting $30 a week. My work on a couple of criminal cases attracted the attention of one of the burglary insurance companies. They offered me a position in their investigating department at $75 a week. Well, I made good. I made so good that I decided to go into business for myself. I organized the different burglary companies into a mutual protective association and got their business. Getting the small fly burglars was easy enough, and I decided to go after the high-class mobs. You wonder how I got on the inside? Through Ira Lazar. And then I stumbled across you, so I decided to kill two birds with a single stone. Oh, I know what you're thinking, and you're right. I took advantage of the love you offered me, and what happened? I owe my life to you. But even more than that, something inside me changed. I began to look at things from a new angle. The human angle. Do you imagine after what I saw you do aboard the boat that I could be the one to destroy you? Do you think that in staying in on the job I was moved by loyalty to my clients or district attorney? The way I felt towards you, Tom, I could have thrown them over like that. Well, if I could have abandoned the job without hurting everyone concerned, I'd have done so long ago. But if I knew that, if I quit, somebody else would take my place and perhaps make it harder for you. You see, once I got this thing started, I ceased to be a free agent. I continued. Well, because you'd grown into my life. I wanted to protect you. I wanted to be near you. I thought of the future. Of your future. Of our future. I saw the better side of you. And I wanted to help you find yourself.
Then in heaven's name, why didn't you tell me this before?
Because I wanted you to come to me. Frankly, openly, and above board.
Oh, Chief!
Yes?
The rest of the gang wants to see Ferris.
All right. Show them in.
Well, Ruth, I'm licked. What are you gonna do with me?
Tom, I'm gonna see that you live up to my expectations of you.
You mean, you're gonna give me a chance to go straight?
I mean, I'm not going to give you a chance to do anything else. You see, I need you now.
You mean, I still got a chance of winning you?
Tom, some women can only love once. I'm one of that kind.
Come in here, the lot of you.
I want to see Ferris.
Yes, where is Ferris?
Boys, it seems to me for a long time you've wanted to see Ferris.
Boys, let me introduce the head of the National Detective Agency, Miss Ruth Ferris.
What?
Oh my God.
I don't believe it.
She's giving it to you straight now! She's Ferris!
Well, if she's Ferris, how did you have her acquitted of shoplifting?
I was her lawyer.
Now, Ira, don't pat yourself on the back for having me acquitted. You see, it was all a frame-up to land you. I had myself arrested just for the pleasure of engaging you as my lawyer.
Ugh.
It was all fixed for the district attorney to let you have me acquitted, because then you'd think me a clever enough crook to use me. And you did. And well, you put me right on the inside of the Stuyvesant job, and while waiting to land you, I ran across the Palmers. That's all there is to it. Oh, Ira, I must say you did play it pretty safe.
Yes, looks it.
You're a fine lawyer, you are.
I told you she was too damn clever for us.
Well, if you want Ferris, I've a proposition to make.
I think I know your proposition, Ira. Sit down, everybody. Now, boys, you want to make restitution of the stolen property in exchange for a light sentence?
Well, I suppose.
Yeah, I'd like that. Ideally, I like to crochet. I need some free time.
What? Well, I accept your proposition, and I'm going to do more than that. You can thank him for it. I'm going to put you all to work.
Oh, what? It's coming!
Oh, God, bury me.
Look, it's come at last.
Call the wagon chief and take me away.
Boys, for a long time you've been preying on society. Now I'm going to give you a chance to come in here and protect society. But I want to tell you this. The first time you hear of a job that's being pulled off and fail to report it, or double-cross me on any case you're working on, it means 20 years.
A chitty-ante!
Now it's up to you.
Why, she's going to turn us all into detectives.
Well, we've had a good education for the job.
Bill, distribute the writing materials. Now, go ahead and write your confessions.
What do you intend to do with these confessions?
Nothing. As long as you remain on the square with me.
Oh, Chief, I forgot to mention it. There's a man from the Carnegie Hero Medal Foundation waiting outside. He wants to see you.
I'll see him in a minute. Oh, by the way, Holmes, you might send in an item to the newspapers that the hero of the Termania disaster has acquired an interest in our agency.
What?
Isn't that so, Tom?
If you say so, Ruth.
Come, come. Busy everybody with the confessions. Remember, it's 20 years or report at this agency for work every morning. Which is it?
Tony, how many D's in murder?
I think it's 3.
Yay!